Hello, everyone. I'm Gary Ling. I'm from SUSE Labs Taipei. And today, I'm going to share the XDP. It's something still under development, I mean, in the kernel. And some of you may be aware that this topic seems similar to the topic last year. But yeah, so this year, I actually put some update in the upstream, so I will introduce XDP briefly and then talk about something new in the upstream kernel. Yeah, okay, let's start it. So what is XDP? Then it means express data path. So before we talk about that, it's a very simple graph to let you know how the network stuff works. So in the beginning, there's the packet was going into a hardware, and there's a receive queue, and the receive queue will be harvested. The packet in the receive queue will be harvested by the NIC driver. Then the driver will send to the network stack and to the network applications, and that's the problem. Is people found that if anything goes well, then this scenario is actually very well. But if something anomaly happened, like the DDoS or something, you don't want to waste your time in the network stack, then like DDoS, some attacker just sending some junk packet to your machine, and you will have to go through all the paths to the network application, and you found this packet junk, so you don't need to actually process that, but you already consume a lot of the CPU power. So that's why the people start to think about, is there any possible to process the packet as early as possible? Then the answer is just put the eBPF program inside the NIC driver. So before the eBPF program was executed, it's just right away after the receive queue. So it's even before the XK buffer allocation. So you don't have to even allocate the memory for those jump packet. And this eBPF program is loaded dynamically, so you don't have to always load this program inside your NIC driver. You can just load it when you need it. And this program is also verified by the eBPF verifier. So you can say it's kind of secure. I would not say it's 100% secure, because anything could happen, but at least it guarantees some kind of security. But it also brings some restriction. So for example, your eBPF program cannot have more than 4,096 instructions. So this may be not so inconvenient for some applications, but you can break down your application to the very, very code, and to make sure the application just filter those packets you need, and so you can just drop those packets you don't need. And this program also can inspect and modify the packets, so it's not just looking into the packet. You actually can write some data into the packet. So, and also it provides some like the packet header and header run. So actually you can add some header before to the packet. So it's not just the inspect the packet. You can modify the packet and also add a header to the packet. And There are some actions was defined for the eBPF program. So after you run the eBPF program, then you have to return the value and to tell the program that what kind of action you should take. So currently there are several actions, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah, five actions. But the first two are basically very, very similar. Like the first one is XDP abort, and this means just means something going wrong in your eBPF program. So it just abort the it just drop the packet. And the other one is the XDP drop. So if you find this packet is just a junk, it's just a junk, and then you just drop it. And so you can just return XDP drop. Then the other one is XDP pass. So XDP pass is just means this packet is totally fine for the network stack, and I don't want to touch it anymore. So it's just sending the packet to the network stack. And the XDD TX is to sending the packet right through the send NIC. So it's a bit different from the NAS, it's the XDP redirect. And this is the new one I'm gonna to mention later. So this is for TX is to sending the packets through the send NIC, and the redirect is to redirect the packet to another NIC or even CPU or like the new FSDP socket. So if I want to summarize the XDP, I would like use this graph. So yeah, your packet go inside from the Ice Cube, then going to your NIC driver, and then you will inspect by the eBPF program. Then you can do the decision, like you can transmit to the TSQ, or just drop the packet, or just pass to the network stack, or you can redirect to the redirect map. It's a special map to indicate the destination. And currently, there are some use case for XDP. And the first one is the original idea. This what he invented for is for the DDoS attack and mitigation. And so, yeah, it's very. So just like I said, it's just inspect the packet and make sure that this packet is this packet you want, and drop the packet you don't want. So at least you can ease the loading of your system. And it also can use as like load balancing. And so it's combined like the SDP TX or the SDP redirect. So you can when you receive a packet and you found that this packet your system may be overloaded, and you have a candidate server to sending to process the packet, then you can sending them to the another server, and so you can just use a TX or redirect to sending out those packets to redirect those packets. And the tunneling also I mentioned, like there's a header room, extra header room for every packet. So actually you can add some header and make something like a tunnel to sending the packet afterward. And you also, yeah, it's very obviously because you are inspecting the packet, so you can use it as a network sampling or network monitoring to collecting the data and see how it works. And there are more because it's still under development, so maybe there are some new use case after. Okay, so this is a very simple introduction to the XDP. And now I will go into introduce the XDP redirect, because this is a new XDP redirect. It actually was wanted in the very, very beginning, but there are some technical issues so that they propose the XDP TX instead, but it's not going to fulfill all those situations. So until now, the until 4.15, I remember, yeah. So the XDP redirect was completed with the devel map. This first eBPF map for the XDP redirect. And so how it works? Then the idea is very simple. It's just to sending your packet to another network card. So you will see that there's the Devmap here. Then you maybe put some your like NIC A in some entry. And so when the packet comes in, and your eBPF program just check this table. And by the way, this is a hash table, so you can just put it into any put the entry in any entry. And you have to specify the entry number in your eBPF program. And so you look up the map and you found there's a destination you can go. So then you found this is a place you go. And then you call like a SDP redirect map. So then afterward, the eBPF program will sending the packet to like sending a packet to the NIC, but not immediately to sending to the NIC, because the if you doing that too frequently, then maybe lower the performance may be lower. So then currently there's a design for called a bunk queue. So every time you redirect the packet to the network card, then you will send it to the bunk queue first. Then this bunk queue is actually like a per CPU array. So you sending the array of the CPU. Then either the API pooling is finished, or either the bunk queue is full. Then these two cases, it will trigger the flush, and the flush all the packet in the bunk queue all together to the network card. So it's kind of an interesting performance tuning. And I also mentioned that SDP redirect, especially for the redirect to another network card, is was wanted in the very, very beginning. But I will explain, and so this is why I explain why it's not implemented in the very beginning. So for SDP, you have to implement the special memory model, because you need to recycle your patch very fast. And so for the conventional ice buffer, and then for the driver, I mean, usually you allocate a buffer and just put the packet inside a buffer, and that's it. You'll see like this, so your packet may be close to two patches. And in this case, if you want to recycle you want to drop this purple packet, then it will be very, very difficult, because you have to touch two patches, and you have to maybe you have to move all everything forward and to avoid the fragmentation, whatever. So they propose another memory model for XDP. So for the driver like NXL5 or NXL4, they will change the memory model if you enable the XDP mode. So if after you enable the XDP, then you will put the packet every patch will put only one packet. So it looks like this. And if you want to drop this packet, you just drop and recycle this patch. So it can be recycling the memory fast. But there's another problem is you see there's a waste of the buffer. So this is just kind of trade-off. And however, for other network card driver like ISBE and I40E, they actually use another memory model for this, and they use like one page and two packet. But it's actually very similar. But anyway, so they are using different approach to do the faster recycling. Then now we go back to the XDP redirect. So for redirect, it means you have to redirect your packet to another network driver. Then if you're doing that in your own driver, then it's well, because you just move the patch you allocate. But if you move the patch to another driver, then how to recycling the driver could be a problem. So because you don't you still want to manage your patch, but you need some way, you need a method to tracking this kind of a patch. So that's why the SDP they propose a kind of patch pool. So the idea of patch pool is to use There's a hash table, and then it will generate the ID for every driver. So every driver before you start, you have to use register the memory model and to the table. So you will get an ID, and you will assign a patch pool for you. And so every time you want to allocate patches, you allocate the patches from the patch pool. And the patch pool will you follow with the ID. So after you redirect the patch to the another driver, then it still knows where it comes from. So after you recycle it, after the driver B is has processed the patch, then it calls the SDP return friend. So then this API will check the ID and to return the patch to the right pool. So every time you just allocate the two from the same pool, I mean, for driver A, you don't have to worry about your patch was lost and I have to allocate a new patch or whatever. So it's just allocated from the patch pool, and then it will help you to collecting all those patches was reclaimed by the other drivers. So after the patch pool was implemented, and so then the first SDP redirect was it, and then can be done. So yeah, this is the first SDP redirect map. Then after that, people start to think about maybe we can do something for a redirect. So they also invent another map called the Cpumap. So yeah, from the name you can know it's a map for every CPU. Yeah, actually you can see there's a kind of hash table array, and the index of the table is actually the CPU number, the CPU ID. So if you want to send in your packet to some CPU array, then CPU ring, then you can just check the CPU ID, and just if the queue was allocated, then there will be an entry like a PTR ring and indicated to the CPU A queue. Like this case, I want to send in my packet to a CPU A Q, and then you can just check this table and see the entry index A, and you find the pointer, and then you find the queue. So later, and similar to the Devmap, yeah, there's also a bunker queue. So you when you call the SDP redirect map, and then your packet will send in the queue first, and then flush to the CPU A queue later. Then yeah, the queue is just not just the queue, and actually when you allocate the queue for CPU A, then you also create a cache rate, and the cache rate is called the CPU map, and there's the number and the map and the ID. So this cache rate is actually very simple. It's just packaging your packet into the SK buffer. So yeah, it's just like you sending you're sending a packet to a specific CPU and tell the CPU to do the SK buffer packing for you. So it's very looks like the IFS and RPS. Yeah, it's very very similar. Yeah, and if you know that, because but the one advantage is the CPU map is more customizable. Because like RPS and RFS is sending the packet to a CPU according to the hash you get, so yeah, you have to tune in the hash function for all the things. But if you're using the CPU map, you can do some very simple algorithm inside the eBPF program, then just check some field and say that this packet should go CPU A, then this packet should go CPU B, and afterward, and you can maybe fulfill your need. So you can just if it's RPS and RFS is good for you, then maybe you can just keep using. Then if it's missing something and you do want to change the rule, but you don't know how to do that, then maybe you can try the CPU map. So you can access the you can check and pack it freely and to do anything you want. Yeah. And the third one is the Xskmap. So this is the most interesting one, and so this maybe I have to spend more time on this. And yeah, like the previous two, and there's also a table for the map, but the destination is quite spatial. It's called the AFSDP socket. And every AFSDP socket, it comes with it's called the SDP U memory, and this memory is very special because this memory is located by the user space program, not by the kernel. So it's very funny. You can redirect the packet right away to the user space memory. So it's like, yeah, it's kind of a kernel bypassing. So if you redirect to the FSDP socket, then you just bypass the old network stack, and you don't have to. But you have to process the packet on your own. So what then I will explain what is the U memory. So yeah, U memory is kind of special memory allocated by the user space, and you have to align to the page size, and of course, or there will be some difficulty to merge the memory page. So first of all, you have to allocate align to your page size. Then you have to specify the page the trunk. That's a trunk. So ideally, you maybe can chuck your own U memory to according the page size. But sometimes like a normal NTU just 1,500. So you don't really need a page for the whole a packet. So maybe you can cut down the trunk to the 2K, and so you don't have to waste a lot of memory on that. Then after you cut after you setting the trunk size, then there will be some special ring buffer related to your you have to setting to for your for U memory U memory. And the ring buffer is actually just some array with a pointer and to pointer to the trunk you are feeding in. And all the ring buffer for the U memory, you have to there's only one producer and one consumer. So there's a special ring buffer, and there are four special ring buffers. So yeah, and those are the ring buffers. You can call it like a fill ring, X ring, or TS ring, or completion ring. Those four buffers will be allocated as well as you allocate the U memory. And you also have to set in the size of those buffers, those ring buffers. And actually, if you look into the source code, kernel source code, sometimes you'll see the fill queue or completion queue, but they are basically meaning the same thing. And for convenience, I just call all of them are rings. So then what the usage of those rings, then is basically you just passing the trunk, those trunks, back and forth through the user space application and the kernel. So for the receiving, you put all the trunks through to the fill ring, and the fill ring will be used by the kernel when there's a new packet was received. Then every time the kernel found a new packet was redirected to the FSD socket, and you grab the chunk from the field ring, and then put the packet inside the trunk and fill back and sending into the RX ring. So you can see there's a cycle, and the USB user space application sending the trunk to the kernel, and the kernel fill the trunk with the packet it received and through the RX ring. So we can see that for receiving there's a cycle here. And similarly, there's a for the transmission, and the user space just putting the free trunk into the TX ring, and later when the user space application sending something through the socket, then the user space the kernel will grab the trunk from the TX ring, then sending all those packets to the destination, and I mean out of the network. So then it's time to recycle the trunks from the TS ring. So then you are sending the trunks to the completion ring. Then so the user space application can just grab the trunks, recycling the trunks from the completion ring. So you can see that there's also a cycle here. So for the kind of more detail, you can see like this. For the very beginning, you allocate the XDP U memory, and then it may be mapping to the kernel. So when you receive a packet, then the network driver will use the memory copy to copy into the trunks. This is the trunks mapping to your memory. So you can see here and notify the user space program through the X ring. So the application can just put in the X ring and to get those trunks and also the packet. It's time out. Oh, sorry. Okay, and I should leave this. Oh, okay. So, okay, if you see a slide, I put some notification so you can see it. And there is another mode, it's called zero copy mode. I have no time to spend that on it anyway, but it's the idea is very simple. It's just you can think about the driver just DNA to the ice trunk, and so everything just direct to sending to the user space, and similar to RTX, you also do the same thing. So it's just you don't have to copy the memory around. So okay, let's quickly do a summary. So I introduced the XDP and briefly, so you know the two processing the packet earlier with XDP, and also introduced the newly added the XDP redirect, and it's currently very limited because there are only a few drivers support XDP redirect, like SGB, I40E, and NLSFI, Vertigo Net. And there's also a very interesting thing is the FSDP is a most you can call it officially kernel bypass, and it's more looks like a replacement for DBDK, but anyway, it's still not mature, so maybe there will be more numbers for that, and so people will maybe considering to switch to this. And there's incoming zero copy support is in the I40E and in the BPF Nest, so it's not in the mainnet yet. So currently, if you use the mainnet kernel, then there's no zero copy driver now. And the other interesting scenario, maybe use the Vertigo plus the FSDP and the zero copy. And this could be the sounds like a very software style SRIOV, and but this is still, I mean, I saw this idea somewhere, and Yeah, it sounds very interesting. But I think SILV maybe still have better performance, but this one maybe have maybe more generic. I mean, yeah, it's a software style, so it's generic. Okay, I guess I run out of time, so very sorry. Maybe I don't have time for question. So if you have question, can come to me offline. Okay, thank you.